so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright flag filled the perilous fight. O'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare.
Called the zone of being. In this zone, these people are going to colonize the rest of the world, appropriate wealth resources of the rest of the world, and the majority of the population of the world are going to be classified in the zone of non-being as inferior subjects that are going to be placed below the line of the human. That means that the people below the line of the human, because their humanity is not recognized, the methods of managing conflict in that zone is going to be violence and dispossession. And so that the beginning of that system is 1492. And that system of violence towards people, non-Western people, and that system of continuous appropriation of their wealth and resources, labor, etc., is going to be a fundamental structure that is going to continue until today. And if you watch carefully, the Guantanamo base is a continuation of that. It's a colonial space. It's a continuation of that history.
...1492 changed the DNA of the human species by opening up a process through which murder and genocide was not introduced and invented, but definitely upgraded. And it laid the foundation for several massacres and genocides that would come in the centuries. Because we normalized it.
Well, 1492 is the moment when the Spanish monarchy conquered Islamic Sultanate of Granada. That's in January 2, 1492. And 10 months later, they were arriving to the Americas to colonize America. So the whole process is one single process from Granada to the conquest of the America the same year. So the European colonial expansion began with the conquest of Granada, not with the conquest of the Americas. You see, and therefore Islamophobia, anti-indigenous racism was there from the beginning.
Well, America's had a very spotty record since the Indians, since the 17th century. So it's always been an up and down situation in the United States. We've had very bad periods. Apart from the genocide of the American Indians, you had the Civil War in the 1860s to get the slaves freed. You had the Japanese put into camps during the Second World War in the United States. You then had the former slaves under huge impediments for 100 years through the 60s.
I don't really believe that Guantanamo, or indeed the way that the whole war on terror has, so-called war on terror has turned, would have been possible without the element of Islamophobia and racism. In the form of creating others, on one side you create nationalism, supernationalism, and other side you actually create otherness, you know, and then you could do everything to the others because they're not one of you. They are almost removed from a concept of humanity and human beings. And this is a sort of a concept that have actually been used very effectively for bonding and mobilizing a nation at the times of difficulty. It was done at the time of Nazis by Nazis. It was done by the Serb in former Yugoslavia. And if you actually go back into the history, you see that that was the concept behind in the so-called Holy War and the Crusade.
Well, if you look at American history, I mean, it's full of examples of utter horror. I mean, think of the genocide of the native people of America, the use of smallpox blankets to infect them, the killings. If you look at the way what the African-American experience has been, if you look at the prisons in America, who they're full of, you know, that's enough. Those really are evidence of American crimes. But you also can look across the world, look at what they did in Vietnam, what they did in Korea, what they're doing in Afghanistan, in Yemen, what they did in Libya. I mean, how many examples can we have? What they did in Abu Ghraib, small and big incidents and mega incidents.
The kickings and shoutings and kickings, yes. And chains, lots of chains and straps to the floor. Many people on top of each other, people throwing up, people sick. I was sick. And one of the most miserable journeys you can ever imagine. The only thing you can think you can might have seen something similar to it is if you saw the film where they transfer slaves in boats from Africa to the Americas. That's the only similitude you can make, you know, it's similar to that, with chains and beatings and...
I see Guantanamo as a continuity of that history of Islamophobia, anti-black racism, anti-indigenous racism that began in 1492.
Since 9/11, we've seen an incredible backward move in the United States. I mean, I can really say in my 50 or 60 years, 40 years of being a lawyer, I lived through the McCarthy period when they went after everybody who was a communist, and this is much worse. What they've done now, what the government has done, is reverse really 200 years of our Constitution, which said that every human being has a right to go to court to test their detention, and no one can be simply tossed into some prison cell by the executive or the king. And that right actually goes back to right here in England. It goes back to the Magna Carta of 1215. So in one way you can say that the United States has gone, in 10 years, it's gone back 900 years in terms of fundamental rights.
The whole question if indigenous people had a sword or not came back to Europe to say that Muslims and Jews are soulless people, people without soul, like indigenous people in the Americas. And so you have in the early 16th century already the formation of this modern racism.
The legacy of 1492 is felt quite simply because it did not end. I mean, when we start to understand time in a different sense and remember that the past is not over, you know, it's still present, then you start to realize that 1492 is every day until you interrupt it.
America's certainly not a post-racial state in the sense that racism is still a structural feature of US society in multiple ways. I think what's interesting about the use of this phrase post-racial, which we've seen especially since the beginning of the Obama presidency, is that it becomes a way in which you can actually institutionalize racism that much more effectively by talking about being in a post-racial moment.
Yeah, Yes, I think, you know, people who believe that we live in a post-racial world must be either completely crazy or, you know, the ultimate exploiters. Because, I mean, if you look at Britain, some people say that in Britain there's no need now to fight racism. I've never heard anything more ridiculous. I've lived here from the late 60s on. And I think that in the last 10 years, racism has grown and grown and grown. I think it's much more racist in some ways. It's different. It's not the same as before. It's been reconfigured to include Muslims in a big way.
Began working on the Guantanamo issues really shortly after 9/11. The President of the United States came down with an order that said he could pick up any non-citizen anywhere in the world, hold him forever. We didn't know it would be Guantanamo, and they would have no legal rights. We wouldn't even know their names. And we said to ourselves, this is outrageous. You can't do this. Every human being deserves a trial. Every human being deserves charges if he's going to be held. And every human being should have the right to go to court. And then, of course, on January 11th, we found out that the place that the U.S. would choose would be Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, which is a U.S. military base in Cuba. And really, since that time, now some 10 years, almost 800 people have gone through that offshore, lawless prison.
I remember vividly how I felt when they announced Guantanamo back in late 2001. I was aghast. You know, here we are as a nation, and I speak as an American here, saying that we're fighting this battle to preserve the rule of law and democracy. What's the first thing we do? We set up a prison in Cuba, which we've said for 50 years has no rule of law. We do it there so we can avoid anyone having any legal rights. And we say we're going to hold them without lawyers, without charges, without anything, but we might execute a few people if we feel like it. It was so hypocritical. And, you know, hypocrisy tends to be the yeast that ferments hatred around the world. And I was horrified. I mean, was I surprised? No, not really. But I was horrified.
It was very shocking because, you know, it was coming after the fall of sort of Soviet Union, and sort of the feeling internationally that things are going to be better. We just came back from Durban conference, the UN conference on racism, and there was a lot of uplifting. You know, we are in the new era of sort of human rights. There is not this trading between the East and the West, and the compromises on the issue of justice and human rights, and we are going to move forward rapidly. And then 9/11 happened. And then shortly after that, we saw Guantanamo, the creation of this black hole of justice.
And we have been representing people from the very beginning. When we began, there was no one who would touch the cases. The only people in the United States who would do anything were my office and Clive Stafford Smith, and that was it. And we got hate mail, hundreds of pieces of hate mail. It was considered to be representing, I mean, Hitler or something like that, for us to be representing people who had not even been charged with a crime.
And it was also very shocking that those images of people being sort of transported from background to Guantanamo in the sort of military plane, chained on the floor of the planes with the photographs. And indeed, some of the photographs that was released, it was very shocking. And those of us who realized and knew that this was released by Americans themselves, i.e. saying that, look, we could do this, you know, and we are proud of it, and we are not even going to hide sort of our abuses or the destruction and undermining of the due process, we're just going to find ways around it, was also very telling and very disturbing.
They took me straight to an isolation cell. Usually that's what happens. Anyone who comes in first thing is they put him in isolation. So I was put in Oscar block. This is the worst block. It's in complete isolation. The cell, I don't know, I haven't seen it in pictures. They keep taking pictures of other cells, like Camp 5, another camp. But this one, the cell looks like a fridge, like a complete refrigerator. It's completely closed from everywhere by iron sheets. Iron walls, iron floors, iron ceiling, and glaring light, and 2 meters, only 2 meters to 2 meters. And it had a really large hole in the ceiling, really large, where concentrated, really cold air will come in. So you were like chained or locked in a fridge. This was the nearest thing you can imagine it, is you being locked up in a fridge. So I was locked up in this fridge for 40 days to 50 days, and I was again interrogated by another guy. And the interesting thing in this, the second interrogation was here where they asked me the stupid question, do you know where Osama bin Laden was? I mean, this is... That's silly.
When they first removed the hood off my eyes, basically, you know, I could see where I was. I saw that I was basically surrounded by probably about 20 maybe more, like American, like military personnel. I was in we call it the clinic or the doctors, but it was some sort of like processing place, like. And I remember looking to my right and seeing a black American soldier who was very tall and very wide, and he was the one holding me. He was holding me by the throat, basically. I don't remember if they let my hand. I think my hands are still tied. I can't remember. But basically, yeah. So he was holding me by the throat to make sure that I didn't do anything. So, Then I saw my orange jumpsuit, or the orange clothes that were on me. So I basically, you know, saw that I was now in the appropriate clothing.
Guantanamo is, you know, a place without due process for foreigners. But a lot of the machinery of it is the same as the machinery of the US system. The main thing that's horrible about the US system is the sheer numbers of people involved. That it imprisons per capita way in excess of anybody else in the world. It is the most punitive nation on earth. That's absolutely disgraceful. And, you know, if I were an American, that would obsess me. But it isn't just that so many people are deprived of their liberty. It's also that within the system, people are tortured as a routine matter. So somewhere between 20,000 and 100,000 people in the United States within the domestic prison system are subjected to long-term solitary confinement. The permanent deprivation of human contact, which is torture. You do that to someone for a month and you're risking causing the precipitous mental collapse of somebody. There are people in the United States domestic prison system who are imprisoned in this manner for decades.
When you think about Guantanamo as contrasted to death row. I've been to most death rows in America. And it's a sort of sad thing to have to say, but I think Guantanamo is worse than any death row by far. Now, the main thing that sets it apart is not so much the physical conditions, although the physical conditions of Guantanamo are horrible, but actually it's the notion that you as a prisoner can be held without trial forever. Worse yet, you can be told you're cleared for release and still held forever. You can be acquitted at a military commission and still held forever. And the psychological impact of that on prisoners, you just can't overestimate, because it just drives people to despair. And the people I represent down there, and I still represent a lot of them, are so depressed these days, by and large, because they see no future, they see no hope. You know, when you're on death row, you've had a trial, however unfair it was, you've got an appeal, you might win the appeal. If you do win the appeal, you might, you know, get out, or you might get executed, and that's the end of your misery, or whatever. You know, there are at least definite aspects to it, however bad they might be. In Guantanamo, it's just endless uncertainty. And I suppose, you know, when you kick a dog, and the dog just doesn't know how it's going to be treated from one second to the next, inconsistency is worse than constant beating, in a way. And that I suppose, is a bit like what we do to prisoners.
We've subjected to beatings, physical abuse, put in a cell, very small cell, 2 meters into two meters with glaring lights, subjected to very, very cold. We were in the cell and then very cold air coming in, and then sometimes put to extremes like very hot air, and chained all the time. Chains, this was the norm, like hands were chained to the legs and chained in stress position. Some people were beaten to death, some people died. I know of people, I was there, witness to people's death. There were people who, I was injured, my eyes, both of my eyes, they tried to gouge both of my eyes. I lost the sight of one of my eyes.
I was put in some stress positions, exposed to, like, you know, cold temperatures and isolation with, like, you know, no clothing, or just my shorts. Extreme exposed to, like, extreme heat and interrogation. Again, in stress positions, you know, being left there for a long period of time. So, you know, then maximum isolation, being away from, like, you know, the general population, everyone basically just being in a cage, but, like, you know, by yourself, so you can't hear anyone, can't see anything, can't see no daylight. So I think, you know, with me, like, they were more focused on, like, you know, mental, breaking you mentally and spiritually, rather than, like, you know, physically hurting you. But obviously, you know, if you're tired or restricted or confined to a certain position for a long period of time, then that will affect you, innit?
My fingers was broken. If you look here, you can see that this one was broken completely, and they have some iron bars. The bones came out because I was trying to stop an officer from spraying something on my face. So he had my hands out, and he closed the door on it, and he broke it. My ribs are battered badly. My nose is broken. Other people were physically, like, some other people, they had their heads, we all had our heads banged on the floor, but some other people had problems because of that, their bones were structured, and things like that. I mean, psychological mistreatment sometimes is worse. They had all sorts of programs going on where they would attack religion, attack you and family and so on. Yeah, so this is generally what went on in Guantanamo.
What we don't know is, you know, the number of people who have been completely crushed by this, destroyed mentally. You know, when the Tipton 3 left Guantanamo in 2004, they said they reckoned there were 50 people there who were just destroyed. Maybe those guys are still there. Maybe the United States released a few of them, but maybe amongst the people that are still in Guantanamo are these very, very damaged people.
What white people do you have here in Guantanamo Bay? This is a place. This is a place for Muslims. When American terrorists are arrested, they don't come to Guantanamo Bay. They get full due process in a federal court system in the mainland of the United States.
So Guantanamo stands really in the public's mind, in my mind, in the world's mind, stands first of all for incommunicado detention, no court. It stands for torture, and it stands for the oppression of Muslims, very clearly. I've said it before and I'll say it again, Guantanamo would not exist if that was a Guantanamo for Christians or if it was a Guantanamo for Jews. So it really, in some ways, stands for this nation, this Christian nation, against a Muslim nation.
Do y'all feel like there's been a rise in Islamophobia in America since 9/11?
Yes, we do. Definitely, yes.
A little bit more due to the media. Media has been pushing it much and much more.
Absolutely. I see it every day.
Yes, I'm actually a student at Conley High School, and there's always racism in school. A lot of the younger generations are affected by it.
I started wearing the scarf right before 9/11. My so-called friends called me towelhead and, you know, made so many insults about, you know, you killed all those people. It was very, very frustrating in the beginning, and every time you'd go to a mosque, it was totally empty because everybody was afraid. It's been really rough. It has totally, totally changed.
I was targeted on the bus one day. A driver had told me that, because I asked him to lower the bus for me because of my leg, and he said that the reason why I'm not going to lower for you because I think you have a bomb underneath your dress. And that was very inappropriate for a driver on a transit city bus to say that to me, and I felt very hurt. A lot of times out here in the media and stuff, we all being targeted, and especially after 9/11. And it's not fair that we be talking like this, because it's one of the constitutions that you allow freedom of religion. It's a constitutional right.
The story of Guantanamo is a story of how the war on terror has been normalized, right? So initially, Guantanamo opens. It's this kind of dramatic thing where, you know, the U.S. government is showing the world these images of these guys in orange suits in cages, and this is shocking around the world. And you get the sense that the government has deliberately released these images in order to intimidate and to shock the world.
Guantanamo is at this point a public symbol that the U.S. doesn't seem to be embarrassed by. They talk about it all the time. You can send news teams down there. And so you have to ask yourself, what are they doing? This is not a secret prison that no one knows about. This is one the U.S. knows about, the population knows about, and the world knows about. And in some way you can say that with the recent legislation that basically made the law of Guantanamo the law of the United States, that they're trying to get people used to the idea that preventive detention is something that we may have to use in certain circumstances. And so as we look to a future, I would like to say we could look to a future without Guantanamos, but it seems that my government wants to say, when we need to, we will have more Guantanamos, whether at Guantanamo or somewhere else.
This law is a terrible law because this law can allow the government to do whatever. Okay, now we're talking about that the state have the possibility of incarcerating anybody for whatever reason. There's no limitation to how far they can go with this law. So in a sense, the institutional framework of fascism is already there in the USA. All it takes is to massify the process of incarceration to get a president or a leadership ready to incarcerate people in mass numbers. That's all it takes, because the institutional framework is already there. They don't need to put new laws or to put new institutions to achieve this. Now everything is put in place. It all depends now if the government wants to do it or not, which is a scary thing when you think about it. It's the end of the Bills of Rights of the USA.
You know, the NDA is troubling because it may be that it is aimed very broadly at anybody that is regarded as a threat outside of the parameters of what was established after 9/11. After 9/11, it was the authorization for use of military force, which specifically is Al-Qaeda, Taliban, people supporting or involved in somehow 9/11. And this appears to be broadening it to deal with new conflicts and new situations where people are regarded as a threat, with the possibility of holding them indefinitely, where the only previous example of that taking place is Guantanamo.
But really, this is a terrible thing, because here you have a president who came to power calling to close Guantanamo and ended up Guantanamoizing the whole country. There's been movement against Guantanamo, but not a mass movement or a significant movement that will stop it. So in that sense, there is a complicity in everyday life to the existence of Guantanamo. This could remind us of Nazi Germany. So in the US, you have this feeling, this atmosphere, where you live normal everyday life at the same time that you know that your government is killing with drones, you know, in Yemen, everyday people. At the same time that you know that with the resources and weapons of the USA, Israel is killing Palestinians every day. At the same time, you know that American forces are killing Afghanian civilians every single day. At the same time that you know that Guantanamo is there, at the same time that you know that the prison industrial complex have millions of Black and Latino youth incarcerated there. The lot of them with mandatory sentences are absurd. In which they basically with fabricated cases, mandatory sentences that are absurd, a crazy situation. So all of this coexists, and the indifference is like you get this atmosphere and feeling as if you were in a place like Nazi Germany.
About Guantanamo Bay, should it be shut down?
I actually think that they should keep it open due to the fact that I'm guessing the people who are in charge of throwing people in Guantanamo Bay are probably educated well enough to make the decisions to put someone away in Guantanamo Bay.
I would say that it should remain open and running just because it's a place to keep all the bad people and punish them for whatever they did to deserve to be there. I mean, well, they just have to move them somewhere different and it just served the same purpose. So there's really no point in closing it down.
Well, I think it should be kept open, mainly because it sounds to me like if they kept it open long enough and let us go and tour it, and I think it would be a great tourist destination, and I'd pay $100 just to go in and see what was going on there, really.
I think that our jailing system is just a little bit overcrowded to begin with, but I think it's definitely important to keep it open because I think it's a good thing, I guess, to keep those that are more dangerous further away from society in a more secure setting. So I think it should be kept open.
I agree. I mean, if you do the crime, you should do the time, and you know, that's the way that our country decides to do it. As far as I'm concerned, they can open back up Alcatraz and put the more national people in there. So I have no problem with it.
I think that it has to do with a larger issue. I think that we as Americans have lost the idea of true justice, and true justice does not come from holding people without a fair trial of their peers. I think that America was built on those foundations of true justice, and we've really come away from that.
I don't think closing Guantanamo is in the narrative because Obama doesn't really want to talk about it. But on the other hand, I think he does want to do it. So it will eventually close. But actually, we've got much bigger problems now because there's a successor to Guantanamo. It may be that Obama's not the Guantanamo president or the Abu Ghraib president, but he's the drones president. And that's the next problem.
By targeting an individual terrorist or a small number of terrorists with ordnance that can be adapted to avoid harming others in the immediate vicinity, it is hard to imagine a tool that can better minimize the risk to civilians than remotely piloted aircraft. For the same reason, targeted strikes conform to the principle of humanity, which requires us to use weapons that will not inflict unnecessary suffering. For all these reasons, I suggest to you that these targeted strikes against Al-Qaeda terrorists are indeed ethical and just.
Drones are remotely controlled aerial devices, which you know, have two purposes. Either they can be used for spying on people, or they can be loaded up with bombs and can then be used to target people. So literally, you know, people are sitting in bases on the United States mainland, controlling devices that are flying over the Afghan-Pakistani border, and are attacking groups of people that are regarded by those who have targeted them as, you know, as a collection of militants and insurgents and terrorists.
Years ago, when I was in Guantanamo, there was someone down there who said, if you carry on insisting that these terrorists have legal rights, we'll just kill them. And I sort of laughed at him, said, you know, you ignorant lout or whatever. But actually that's what's happened, that Obama, who opposes a regime of detention without trial, has adopted a regime of assassination without trial.
It would be impossible not to see this as a conscious replacement for a program that was difficult and messy, because it involved, you know, living people and torture and indefinite detention and lawyers causing problems. So, you know, that's troubling. I mean, everything about the drones is troubling because it's a very modern story, which is clearly wrong, but the technology has allowed those in charge to press ahead with it. You know, it's kind of, its use is outstripping the ability of bodies like the United Nations or of lawyers to argue that what's happening is wrong.
The idea that today we have a kill list, which they euphemistically call a disposition matrix, just horrifying. I mean, there's someone conservative who wrote in the paper the other day, do we want to live in a world where the United States government has a list of 50 or 100 people who they want to murder? I mean, it's just shocking, isn't it?
The drone attacks basically are undermining a number of sort of international law. The most obvious one is the sovereignty of other states, because they go into Pakistan, they're going into Sudan, they're going into Yemen, they go everywhere they want and just assassinate people. The other thing is actually assassination of individuals when there is no war, you know, and you know, this sort of using rockets to kill people when there is no war is actually war crime, especially when it's being done in the arenas, which are, you know, not a war arena. I mean, you know, in villages and people's sort of homes, and so forth. And the whole concept of the due process, that, you know, innocent until proven guilty, people have to be accused of something and needs to go, that accusation needs to be proven in some sort of court, and then sort of some sort of sentence passed. Here, even if you believe in capital punishment, this is not a capital punishment, this is assassination of individual on just mere hearsay.
Clearly, I think it's only able to take place because the essential structure of a global war on terrorism that was established by the Bush administration is still in place. I mean, absolutely is in place and is intact, that, you know, that America is taking out its enemies wherever they are on the face of the earth because it has the right to do that.
Well, the great thing about the US justifying what it does is it doesn't. I mean, having a secret war in Pakistan with the CIA running it means you don't answer any questions. So first, they don't justify it. They do, for their own purposes, have these legal memos that are just like the memos that justified torture. You know, torture wasn't torture. And here, you know, illegal killing's not illegal killing. And somehow, an illegal war in Pakistan is not an illegal war in Pakistan. I mean, it's all nonsense. There's no lawyer who would stand up in public and say that without being laughed at. But they have these little memos that justify for themselves internally what they do and incidentally give them legal cover so you can't get sued. The great thing about the torture memos was, however silly they may have been, they meant that if you, the torturer, had a memo that said this isn't torture, then you couldn't get prosecuted. So that's what they're really all about.
They don't care what the world thinks of them. No, they really don't care. I mean, they try to, the Department of State tried to do policies to, you know, let's say some cosmetic, if, you know, some cosmetic to the face of American imperialism and things like this, but in general, the people don't care about what other people think outside the USA. There's an indifference to that. They have this feeling of arrogance and feeling of superiority over the rest, and this naive idea that the US state is doing something good elsewhere. You know, so there's this innocence about American imperialism, you see, that naive innocence. as if we're doing good, you know. And so this is the kind of atmosphere that you see in the USA today.
You know, there are some of these issues that are theoretical. You know, you may have a theoretical opposition to the death penalty, a theoretical opposition to Guantanamo. But then there become moments when it gets to be deeply personal. And when I went to Pakistan in October 2011, we held a meeting in Islamabad where we brought 80 people from Waziristan in for the first time they'd ever met with Westerners. I was the token American, and there were a few other people from Britain there. And we were just sharing perspectives. I wanted to hear from them. I wanted to tell them what the Americans were saying, and at last begin, perhaps, for people to see each other as human beings. And it was all about drones. And one of the people there was this kid, Tariq Aziz, who was 16 years old, who had come because one of his relatives had been killed. And he just wanted to know what he could do to stop America from killing his family. 3 days later, the United States killed him. And there's only one way it could have happened, and that was because some informant who was being paid by the Americans put a GPS tag on his car. He's driving along with his little cousin, and they're going to pick up his auntie, and kaboom, Hellfire missile killed him and turned him and his cousin into tiny little pieces. And for me, that was the moment when this was no longer theoretical. This had pissed me off. You don't do that to someone who comes to a meeting with me to try and do something about peace. You don't expect to get away with that sort of thing. And if it's the last thing I do, it's going to be to bring killers of Tariq Aziz to justice. Not justice in the sense of vindictiveness, not even to send them to prison. I just want the world to know what they did and for us to say sorry.
So he's very much continuing in very fundamental ways what started with America's response to 9/11. And you know, and it's very deeply disturbing what's happening. Not just that there is no understandable process in place for any accountability, but I think also what's alarming is the way that this is being adopted everywhere. Every regime, whether it's you know, pretty openly authoritarian or one that pretends to be democratic, loves the idea of remotely controlling devices that can either spy on their citizens or kill them from afar.
If United States of America, which thinks and considers itself that a sort of champion of liberty, could get away with this sort of thing and justify it, then why shouldn't others do it? And this is what has been the other problem with the whole issue of, you know, people in Iraq and so forth being picked up and forced to wear the sort of the orange suits and so forth. It's actually creating and passing that culture and legitimizing it in the whole of the world. And that actually is a very, very dangerous concept.
Guantanamo is really iconic for, first, everything the United States is doing wrong in its efforts to, quote, stop terrorism. It stands really for the wrong way to make yourself safe. The right way to make yourself safe, most people probably are aware of it. It's to have a foreign policy that's much fairer. It's to not only go to the wealthier countries. It's to not exploit the peoples of the world. That's the way you make yourself safe. But the United States took itself a law enforcement or war model that believed that by making war on the world, across the Middle East, across Central Asia, and by imposing draconian measures from torture to Guantanamo, that the United States felt it could make the world or itself safer. In fact, of course, it doesn't.
Obama, is it better than Bush? I wouldn't. I mean, it all depends how you judge. Obama is much sort of savvier when he talks. So they really, in reality, when you look at the actions, you know, the increase of use of drone, passing legislations, making Guantanamo possible in United States, and, you know, indeed, you know, increasing the surge in Afghanistan, you'll see that the only difference is, you know, is the language. There is no other difference. If anything, Obama has been much more damaging when it comes to, because he has been able to put a nice face and a nice sort of articulate individual voice to the atrocities that have been taking place, and said, therefore, gone beyond legitimizing this, beyond someone like George W. Bush.
So this is what the liberal President Obama has done, is actually normalized Guantanamo, right? When it was under George W. Bush, there was a controversy around Guantanamo. It was like, you could argue for and against. I mean, now it's just kind of been normalized.
And I remember when he was given the Nobel Peace Prize, and I sort of thought, you know, this guy promised to close Guantanamo, he hasn't. Weeks before, increased the surge in Afghanistan, and he gets the Nobel Prize. I thought, well, really, if anyone deserved Nobel Prize, is actually he's a speechwriter, and really, that's the honest the thing. He's a speechwriter, is very good, and he's very good in delivering his speeches. Otherwise, actions, I don't see any difference.
When you look from World War II onwards through the last half of the 20th century, it was a story of movement towards human rights. And the last 10 years have seen a resurgence of some really medieval views.
My hope is that Guantanamo will be shut tomorrow, if not yesterday. Unfortunately, I think we're looking at a very long time before Guantanamo is shut down. My hope comes out of the fact that hundreds of demonstrations are going across the United States right now and across the world to close it down. If it closes down, it's not going to be because my government says one day we're going to close it out of their goodwill. It's going to be because the peoples of the world have said enough, we're closing it. At that point, I think it will be looked at much like we looked at slavery, much like we looked at putting the Japanese in camps, much like we looked at dropping the atom bomb on Japan. It will be looked at as a shame of America. And people will say, you know, now that it's already happened, they will say, never again.
The American dream, for example, goes together with the American nightmare. And there's no American dream without the American nightmare. That is, there wouldn't be a white American dreaming America without the American nightmare of slavery of African American, without the American nightmare of genocide to indigenous people, without the American nightmare of colonization of northern Mexico, of Puerto Rico, of Pacific Islands, etc. You know, so the two things go together and they're perfectly coherent. Part of the problem is to believe that because you have zones of being in the U.S., people think, oh, it's a contradiction that the U.S. have a place like Guantanamo or a place like prison industrial complex or like ghettos and things like that. It's not a contradiction. Within the racist paradigm, the two worlds coexist perfectly. And not only that, the world of the zone of being needs of the zone of non-being to be able to exist, because they get the resources, they get the many things that they appropriate from the zone of non-being, you see. So we shouldn't see liberalism on one side and, you know, lawlessness and violence in the other as a contradiction.